There is nothing more complicated in medicine, all of medicine, than what I'm going to talk about, which is the genetic-genomic revolution. So you're a patient, or you're a family member, and you have a diagnosis of cancer, and or you've had a diagnosis of cancer, and you're at some point in your journey, and someone starts talking to you about genetics, genomics, molecular abnormalities, targeted therapies. It's unbelievably confusing. And the oncologist says, well, I'm not really sure what we do, and you know, maybe we try this, and by the way, there aren't trials. Who does that patient go to? Who does the family go to get advice, to get help? You. You know what I'm talking about. So I'm here to try over the next 40 minutes or so to make a little bit of sense of it and maybe give a little framework for where we're going. Now, I'm going to focus on, and I'll explain the difference between genetics and genomics, at least my definition in a moment, but what I would hope when we're done with the conversation is I make a little bit of sense to it and where we might be going. It's a process. It's not an event. And I would argue this is the future. And although I will allude to this particularly at the beginning, I won't spend much time on it. This is the future of medicine. I just can't be clearer about it. And I'll actually explain a little bit why I say that as I go along. So that's my introduction. I'm not trying to get up here. I'm not going to, you know, at the end ask you, you know, tell me about the latest new drugs that we're using in cancer medicine and what is the molecular target. That's not the intent. I'll give you a couple of examples only to show you where we're going. But I really want to help give a framework so you yourselves can think about this when you're confronted, which you will be, with patients. And by the way, at the beginning, I'm going to talk a little bit about genetic risk, which is where you'll really be confronted with this. My talk will be mostly on the kind of with the diagnosis of cancer, and we're looking at the genetics and what do we do with that. But I will say a little bit at the beginning about the genetic part of it, which is much earlier in its development, much more complicated. And again, I was given an hour, not 3 hours, so I couldn't cover all of it. So that's what I'm going to try to accomplish. So first, definitions. I must tell you, one of the most complicated parts about this whole arena are definitions. I'm making them up because there actually is no definition of genomics. And it's all called genetics, and talk about confusion, because the first thing you think about with genetics is whatever you think about genetics. It's all in one's mind. And I'm going to try to distinguish that. Again, you can use this terminology, but the more important part about it is understanding the distinctions between, you know, what's in the germline, which is what I'm going to talk about for the next few moments, and then what might be unique in a cancer. My first statement, it's all about our genes. Now, that's obviously a provocative statement. I, of course, don't mean it the way it sounds, but that's, in fact, where we start. That is who we are at a biological level. That's obviously not who we are as people. That's obviously not who we are as we develop. That's not who we are as it relates to environmental exposure. But that background, that core, is our DNA. And it's unbelievably complicated. So to try to make it a little simpler, genetics, I define, or the genetic component of who we are, is that genetic material present in our genes, in our cells, from conception. And will be there unchanged at that core. Again, obviously, there are things that happen. That core will be there to the day we die. Importantly, for the conversation we're having and the conversation you will all be having, and your colleagues and your trainees and their trainees, we will all be having for very long periods of time, is this question of what do we do with the data? What does it mean? And in this context, this information may define or suggest an increased risk for the development of a particular medical condition. Of course, the classic genetic disease is, as I remember as a medical student, and I certainly remember as a, at that point, a father-to-be, more than 30 years ago, let's look for Trisomy 21, let's look for the risk of Down's disease, and let's look for, okay, you know, the woman's over the age of 35. I mean, that's how far back we go. We've known about that, but that seems like light years ago in terms of where we are today. But that was a basic concept. You're looking for an increased risk of something. It could be Down syndrome. It could be a specific type of cancer, which of course is going to be my focus to move on. But there's also other giants in the room, like Alzheimer's disease. What do we do with that? Okay, so there's that increased risk of some illness. But there's also this incredible question out there, and I'm only going to, again, just touch on that. Very complicated. The possibility that that information, again, the genetic information, may possibly lead to a more or less favorable response to a particular treatment strategy. You know, obviously, this could be cardiac disease. It could be management of diabetes. And we are just beginning to get into that area. So, and of course, that relates to the normal human polymorphisms that are present in all of us. So it's not only the risk of some kind of an illness. Again, we'll talk about cancer. But it's also questions of metabolism, questions of drug distribution, questions of increased risk of a side effect for drug A or drug B or C, or the drug won't be metabolized or be metabolized slowly and increasing risk, or it may not be effective. All that's out there. And my point is at a high level, genetics will be increasingly important as this is defined. Today, as you know, all you have to do is read your literature, as I read mine, and it's a morass. It is weekly, sometimes daily. There's another paper that says there's an association between this polymorphism and some condition or some drug. You were just talking about cardiac disease. There's nothing more complicated than that associations. And then the next paper says it isn't true, or it's P is less, not less than 0.05, or whatever. The point is, this is very complicated, and obviously we'll learn as we go along. So focusing on this question of genetics in cancer, we obviously here are potentially talking about risk of cancer. Probably today the most important single association, only because of the incidence that we see, of breast cancer. And there are, again, two classic genes that have been defined, BRCA1 and BRCA2, and obviously there are many more out there. And of course, this has become very popular in terms of the conversation, and I think an important conversation because of the decision by the actress Angelina Jolie to undergo both bilateral mastectomies but also bilateral oophorectomies because of not only the presence of the gene in herself, but she knew about her family history. And this is very real. Again, I'm not going to talk about the data supporting her decisions, which were absolutely medically correct. But the point is, that's the kind of information we are accumulating from the point of view of prophylactic measures that can be taken to substantially reduce the risk of a particular cancer that have now been well-defined in terms of their benefits and outcomes. In colon cancer, Lynch syndrome, named after Henry Lynch, who is, I would say, is the father, still alive, of genetic familial cancers. Of course, in his heyday, he simply described the epidemiology and said, look, there are these families that have colon cancer. Of course, now we know the genetic abnormalities, and Henry Lynch had this syndrome named after him. There are obviously very important syndromes that are related, related to polyposis, et cetera, and they have very complex genetics associated with them. They are less common than breast cancer, but also those. So those are the sort of the two classic today, well-defined, well-characterized, where one can say there's actionable material. Much of what happens when one gets these reports today, there are the genetic associations of undetermined significance. And I know this has got to drive you crazy if you get these reports or if your patients say, what does this mean when the laboratory says it's a genetic abnormality of undetermined significance? Basically means, is there maybe an association we haven't proven yet? And again, to that second item, this genetically defined drug metabolism and deposition. I give one example of this. A very common, a very old chemotherapeutic agent, 5-fluorouracil, has been given to, you know, million plus people over the last 40 to 50 years. And there's a very small percentage of patients who have extraordinary toxicities. Basically, the drug can kill them. We now have evidence of, we can define the genetic abnormality if we chose to do so. We don't, because the risk, the incidence is so low that one has a very hard time justifying that. I will come back to that sort of at the end, but we have that data. And then that's on the toxicity side. And there are other associations. So for example, one of the things, many of the chemotherapies now that we have are increasingly effective, but they cause neuropathy, numbness, tingling of the hands and feet. That wouldn't be so bad, except that it persists. And it can persist for a lifetime. It becomes debilitating. It almost certainly has something to do with the way the drug is distributed. It has something to do with the metabolism of the drug. And there is evidence, unfortunately not clearly definitive, that there is a genetic association, as you'd anticipate. So someday we will be able to hopefully be able to say this is a patient who has a higher risk. And of course, if that higher risk exists, and there are no alternatives but to use drug A because it's curative and there's nothing else, then you use drug A, of course, informing the patient and then hope for the best. On the other hand, if there's an alternative drug B that doesn't cause that side effect, that actually may be the way you want to go. Again, so these are very important bits of information that we will be accumulating as we go along that will very much inform the oncologist's decision. And then, of course, there's this important question of efficacy. I was talking about toxicity, efficacy. One of the classic story there is a drug that I'm sure you're all familiar with, tamoxifen, in the management of breast cancer. Very effective drug, very effective drug. We know that the drug is metabolized very differently in different patients. And in fact, tamoxifen itself is not the active drug. It is metabolized to an active metabolite. And there are slow metabolizers and there are rapid metabolizers. And again, very controversial data suggesting that the slow metabolizers have a less favorable outcome. So some people say, well, give the double the dose. Again, the none of this has been quite proven yet. No one has, you know, put a stamp of approval on this. Do we get the test looking for the, you know, genetic association? Do we not? What's the proof? You know, why don't you give everybody double the dose? Tamoxifen has toxicity in double the dose. That's why we give it the dose we give. So, you know, again, I'm pointing out, at some point, we will start focusing on getting this knowledge and eventually utilizing it in our decisions. I add a few other examples at the bottom that are more specific to oncology, directly to oncology, but to emphasize just how important it is. We actually have evidence today of the importance of the genetics, of course, in transplantation, bone marrow transplantation. That, you know, obviously the genetic profile of the sibling or the unrelated donor is critical in the context of a graft taking versus graft being rejected. And of course, graft versus host disease, where the graft attacks the host, is terrible. On the other hand, we have very strong evidence that the graft, also, assume it isn't rejected by the host or doesn't kill the host, actually can affect the tumor. So that genetic difference can be a positive as well. And finally, I mentioned this incredibly rapidly evolving area of immunotherapy. And the reason I mention that is because you've all heard about it, and it's truly spectacular. What does that have to do with genetics? There is evidence early that in colon cancer specifically, but it may be true in other cancers, if a patient has a genetic background like the Lynch syndrome, meaning there are many abnormalities in the germline, which is the reason why we have mismatch repair and you get the colon cancer in the first place, those patients are particularly susceptible to the favorable effects of immunotherapy because they have so many mutations in the germline. And the immunotherapy can then favorably impact the cancer because of those mutations. More to come on that. Point is, I'm saying there's, I'm just giving you examples of where knowledge of germline may become critically important in the future of the care of cancer patients or the diagnosis of cancer patients or prevention. So now I'm going to turn my attention to the other end of the spectrum, and that's what I will call genomics. And again, there, if you look this up in the Stedman's Medical Dictionary, you will not see this definition. I'm using this so that I can try to distinguish, because it's all genetics, it's all in the genes. But what we're looking for when we are talking about the cancer is something different. So the general term I'll use is abnormalities. And that could be mutations. It could simply be a slight alteration. It could be increased numbers of copies of a normal gene. It could be a complete absence of a gene. Some abnormality present within the genetic material of a particular patient's cancer that is unique to that individual's malignancy. Now that, of course, we're learning about the biology, that abnormality or those abnormalities may in fact lead to what we call cancer, to abnormal local growth, to invasion, to dissemination, and ultimately to treatment resistance. So the fundamental goal of this broad term of precision cancer medicine is to learn to target the specific molecular abnormality to produce a favorable impact. And then before I go on, let me just say something here so it's crystal clear. We are in the absolute infancy of this area, because one of the first things you would say is, or you should say is, wait a minute. As important as the DNA is, the DNA doesn't do anything. The DNA goes to RNA, and more importantly, the RNA goes to proteins. And it is the proteins that are clearly the things that cause cells to do X, Y, and Z. And that's incredibly complex, of course. And then there's the whole topic of epigenetics, that, you know, changing the gene after development, and, you know, that has a lot to do with a lot of fields. So what I want to emphasize here is the concept of precision medicine, cancer medicine, is not genomics itself. It's what is unique in that cancer, and that is ultimately translated from the DNA to the RNA to the proteins, maybe no protein, maybe that's the problem, an altered protein, maybe too much of a protein, et cetera, that somehow is causing that cancer to grow that we potentially could target. So when I talk about the gene and I'm talking about DNA, again, I want to focus on the fact that we are simply at the beginning of this journey. And it is going to be an incredibly important journey. So the terms that are often used, you've heard targeted therapy, personalized therapy, or more recently, precision therapy. And let me just tell you, I like the term precision. And the reason I like it is because I believe it says what we're trying to say. That is, we are trying to be more precise in our therapy. There is no such thing, as we've learned, as the magic bullet. But if we can be more precise, if we can get to that abnormality, more effect on the cancer than on the normal tissue, then we can anticipate, but we have to prove, that our therapeutic outcomes will be superior, both from the perspective of efficacy and toxicity. So it's precision implies to me more precise, nothing perfect about it. And let me emphasize, as clearly as I can, one of the incredible misunderstandings, some of it is just naivete, some of it is also probably intentional. This is not a novel concept. It's not a new concept. In fact, it is the oldest form of cancer therapy we've ever had. It goes back 100 plus years when surgeons took out ovaries of premenopausal women with breast cancer and saw regression, short term of course, of local breast masses as well as metastatic disease. Now, why did taking out the ovaries cause that? They didn't know at the time, but that was a targeted therapy. They were obviously removing estrogen that was driving those cancers. And again, very old strategy, which we use uncommonly today, is orchiectomy in men with prostate cancer, which was, of course, and is to reduce testosterone. Why? Because testosterone impacts the androgen receptor on prostate cancer cells. So this is very old therapy. They didn't know what they were doing at the time. I mean, they saw the observation. They didn't know anything about the androgen receptor. They didn't know anything about testosterone, but that was the therapy. And in fact, now getting a little more scientific, it was more than 40 years ago that the estrogen receptor itself was discovered, subsequently cloned in the laboratory. So for 40 years, we've known this thing is called the estrogen receptor. And again, you know, we've known that women who have ER and PR positive breast cancer have a better prognosis. There have been surgical procedures for breast cancer, as I noted, but obviously increasingly what we do, in fact, that's very rare that we use that now. We have incredibly effective hormonal therapy, all based on that molecular target, which is the estrogen / progesterone receptors. And it was about 20 years ago, maybe 25 years ago, that the fields began to move more to thinking about this as a therapeutic concept when the observation was made that there was another very important receptor on the surface of breast cancer cells, and that was the HER2 receptor. And the observation was noted at the time. Today it's an old story. I'm trying to lead you through this. Today you say, well, we know about that. In fact, we know about that so much that today we actually classify breast cancer on the basis of estrogen progesterone receptor positive or negative, HER2 overexpression, yes or no. And we actually have a third category. It's called triple negative. Unfortunately, it's a very tough category. When a woman is diagnosed, you make that diagnosis today. ER/PR positive, one category. HER2 positive, second category. And the final category is there's nothing there. And the reason is because it obviously is prognostically important, but also therapeutically important. So it's standard of care today. And it was learned at that point that overexpression, a lot of HER2, and they stay in a laboratory, means that those tumors will be very sensitive statistically, and there's a lot of randomized controlled trial data that shows that the use, and the first drug, and we have several out there now, was trastuzumab, it's Herceptin, was extremely effective. But that's because of overexpression of this particular receptor. Again, very interesting, confined to breast cancer, and appeared to be, breast cancer. And then the world changed. I mean changed, with the unbelievably exciting, paradigm-changing observation that there was a molecular abnormality in a tumor known as chronic myelocytic leukemia, CML. You all know that as, I knew it as when I was a medical student, the Philadelphia chromosome. The Philadelphia chromosome actually is the driver. Present there, BCR-ABL, we know about it now, we call it now. There is a very unique abnormality that drives that cancer forward. We found that abnormality, a drug was developed known as imatinib, and that changed the lives of patients of CML overnight. And today, it is fair to say that individuals with CML diagnosed on that therapy probably lead a pretty normal life expectancy taking this drug. That is, again, a very specific molecular abnormality targeted therapy. But that wasn't the profound observation. The profound observation was that there was an entirely different cancer known as GIST, gastrointestinal stromal tumor. Think about the difference. Blood cancer versus a cancer present largely in the gastrointestinal tract, most often in the stomach, solid tumor. The identical molecular abnormality to CML. The identical drug, equally effective. So all of a sudden, people are saying, all we need to do is look for that very simple abnormality in any one cancer. We can find a drug and basically not cure, but control cancer forever. Unfortunately, good thought, makes a good ending in Hollywood. This resulted in an incredible oversimplification of very complex biology. And just to show you one example of that and where we were and where we're going, and then I'll go a little faster. This is really an important baseline to sort of show where we're going. But this is a great example of exuberance, over-exuberance, leading to incredible waste of money, quite frankly, heartbreak for incredible number of patients. But because of this, that we'll find this very quickly, everybody thought it was simple. And it turns out there is another receptor. I mentioned the HER2 receptor. I mentioned the receptors in CML. There's another important receptor that has been seen to be present on actually the majority of cancer cells. It's known as the epidermal growth factor receptor. You probably might have seen that as EGFR. Turns out that basically 80% or maybe 90% of lung cancers have this abnormality. What is the abnormality? Every cell has EGFR in it, but in these cancers, you see lots of this. Just like in, I mentioned a breast cancer, if you see a lot of Herceptin, if you see a lot of HER2, you can target that with Herceptin. So the idea was, we see all of this receptor on the presence of the lung cancer cell, let's just make a drug that affects the epidermal growth factor receptor. Billions of dollars, a dozen pharmaceutical companies were racing to do this. And it turns out that approximately 10%, and on the next slide, you'll see the end of the story, approximately 10% of patients actually had a major response to these drugs. And as an interesting aside, when these drugs were being developed, it was the beginning of the internet era and social media. And for the first time, patients themselves who are participating in these trials were actually posting their own experiences online to online support groups, including their x-rays. You can imagine the frenzy that was going on at the time. This was felt to be an incredible advance, clamoring for getting these drugs approved. All phase three randomized trials were negative, completely negative. No impact on survival of any of these drugs in these studies. And may, some of you may have actually remember that literally the newspaper saying the false promise molecular medicine, completely, you know, worthless, wasted money, et cetera, et cetera. All true. And it took what I consider to be Nobel Prize winning work, absolutely Nobel Prize winning work, a group of scientists in Boston who actually did the correct work and experiments. And this is the future. They said, there's something wrong here. These patients who responded did respond. It was 10%. This wasn't a lie. 90% had no value at all. So as you can imagine, 90% no value. Randomized controlled trials, of course, were completely negative. But there was something there. And to make a very long story short, in several papers published in the New England Journal of Medicine, they identified the abnormality. It wasn't simply a lot of it. It was a particular mutation that was present in the responding patients, small number. Turns out, again, long story short, approximately 20 to 25% of patients with non-small cell lung cancer have this abnormality, a particular mutation. Not all of them. They are the ones that respond. Fascinating. It's more common in women than men. It's more common in Asian population and more common in non-smokers. Obviously, again, much more to be learned, but that's true. Definitive data, randomized phase two trials have now shown that if the mutation is present, if patients now receive these targeted therapies, they do far better than if they get chemotherapy. Number one, there's substantially less toxicity. Number two, and number three, this is now standard of care. So the day that a patient is diagnosed with non-small cell lung cancer, they get one of these tests to find out if they have the mutation. If they have a mutation, they'll get one of these targeted therapies. If they do not have the mutation, they will not. That is the process of precision medicine I'm beginning to describe. And just to give you a few other examples, there's another abnormality known as ALK. Now again, remember, to the previous slide, I said the EGFR mutation is approximately 1 out of 4 to 1 out of 5 lung cancers. ALK, another mutation, is 4 to 5% of patients with lung cancers. That has a completely different biology, completely different drug. I'm saying that we have drugs for effective therapies for these, and that's standard of care now. There's something called ROS1. I'm gonna come back to that at the end of my talk, which will be soon, where, again, a very specific mutation, it's less than 2% of lung cancer patients. The same drug used in ALK, it's a completely different mutation than ALK, but with the same drug that works. In melanoma now, approximately half of the melanomas, there's a particular mutation called BRAF. Very effective therapies are available. I mention this to show you how complex this is. There's actually a unique abnormality in advanced metastatic basal cell carcinoma. As you all know, basal cell carcinoma is an extremely common. Metastatic basal cell cancer is incredibly rare. In my entire career, I've never seen a patient, I've actually never known a patient, of doctor taking care of a patient with a metastatic basal cell carcinoma. It does exist, and we have a therapy for that. And then we have abnormalities that are in diseases like breast cancer and ovarian cancer that relate, again, to BRCA present in the tumor. And we actually have effective therapies there, but here we begin to come into the problem. We are talking about uncommon cancer, that is ovarian cancer, and only 5 to 10% of patients have this abnormality. So the question to be asked is, how do we prove benefit? We have small subsets of patients, yes. 25% of lung cancer still, unfortunately, is a lot of people. And you can do randomized trials, but not 1% of lung cancer. And ovarian cancer, fortunately, is a uncommon cancer. 5% of ovarian cancer patients is a small number of patients. So how does one prove clinical benefit? Is a phase 3 randomized trial always required? How does one achieve FDA approval? And then, of course, there's the quality of the evidence for the clinical utility for the molecular or biological markers. I've sort of passed over that. I've sort of said, oh yeah, there's this test, and it's proven to be a benefit, and we move on. Not so fast. This is all very complex. How do we know the marker is reproducible? How do we know, in fact, and I mentioned there are already some very serious problems of conflict of interest, fraud, even at the institutional, academic institutional level, where there have been lawsuits, et cetera, because there's a lot of money involved in it. How do we know just because somebody reports that there's this abnormality, and this is, again, very complicated stuff, how do we know it's true? And of course, there's also that giant in the room, the insurer's willingness to pay for an antineoplastic therapy based on molecular test results rather than on the traditional results of randomized phase 3 trials. I want to emphasize that there are other ways to look at clinical utility that I need to mention that are critically important that are not randomized trials. And I show this for two reasons. One is because it's very relevant to the question of are there other ways of looking at the data, but I also show this because I think it's very relevant to the population of patients that you will see in your practices. And I could not have had a better introduction into this particular slide than the decision just this week, and apparently it's going to be, the data will be is published in the Annals of Internal Medicine, where the United States Public Health Service Advisory Committee has now suggested the use of aspirin for the prevention and actual after the diagnosis of colon cancer. They, however, didn't look at the molecular abnormalities, which I'll show you here, and I would personally argue this is probably the way we need to go in the future. And this shows the complexities of the issue. I mentioned this is published in the New England Journal of Medicine several years ago. Extraordinary tour de force of these investigators. And this is all very relevant to you, information we've all collected. Has nothing to do with cancer. In 1976, the Nurses' Health Study was initiated, 121,000 nurses. In 1986, 51,000 physicians. Interesting, the nurses were largely female at that point. And of course, back in 1986, the physicians were largely male. Would be different today. That just happens to be these populations they followed starting in those years. And those individuals were followed every year from 1976 or 1986. And when I say followed, they got surveys. What medications are you taking? What's happened to you? You've been hospitalized, et cetera, et cetera. It turned out the 964 patients in that cohort developed colon cancer. And again, in the tour de force, these investigators got those samples sent to them, and they did molecular analyses of these tumors. But the key here is they also had this incredible database of what these people were doing or not doing over those many decades. And again, to make a very long story short, they demonstrated that approximately 1 in 5 of these tumors had a very specific mutation. The mutation is not that important, except there was a very strong biological rationale for why aspirin might favorably impact that mutation, which you certainly can read about. And remarkably, what they found, and this is the summary, that in patients whose tumor possessed this particular mutation, which was 17%, there was an 82% reduction in the risk of death from colon cancer if they took aspirin after diagnosis compared to those patients who didn't take aspirin. And for the 83% of patients whose tumor did not have that mutation, aspirin had no effect. Today, this should be standard of care. I can assure you it is not, because first of all, there's no one's going to sell aspirin. And second of all, for the academic purists in the world, who I'll comment about in a moment again, this is not good enough. You have to do a phase 3 randomized trial that will only take 250 years to do. But the future is here. The sequence of the entire genome of a tumor and the corresponding normal genome of an individual cancer patient can be obtained now in less than 1 week for less than $5,000. 12 to 15 years ago, that, what I just take, would have taken more than a year and $6 billion for the cost. And quite frankly, we're close today, to having a 24-hour genome you can get in 24 hours at a cost of less than $1,000. So the issue is not whether the data will be available to patients. It is available to patients. The tsunami has occurred, crystal clear. But rather, how to optimally convert this massive quantity of raw data into information of genuine value to individual patient management. And I show you this slide. This was published in the Journal of Medicine. I think it's an extraordinary slide. What you see on the top is what you see is cost and then years. And what you, the top black line is Moore's Law. I think, as you all know, Professor Moore, who was one of the founders of Intel, basically said many years ago something that everybody laughed at. He said that we would be able to double the number of transistors that were present on a computer chip every 24 months. He described the computer era. Those terms are why we have smartphones, et cetera, et cetera. He said that was going to happen, and he was right. So going from these giant computers to your smartphone, that's what that was all about. And that rate of improvement compared to decreasing the cost of the human genome, it's extraordinary. So, what are the steps? How do we go from this is all very interesting to finding what's of real value? I simplify this because there's really no way to really look at this in something that it's so massive. I'd sort of describe this as a code or as a map. So if you think about a code or a map, and I use the example of the Enigma code, World War II, you know, you found the code. Somebody says, oh, I got it. I found it. I took it off a German soldier. Here is the code. Got it. That's simple today. Less than 24 hours, cost of $1,000. It's all there. All the billions and billions and billions of bits of data are now there. That's easy. Sequencing. But how about breaking the code? We got the code. We know we have it. How to break it? That's this field now of bioinformatics. This is going to be anywhere from difficult to extremely difficult. In other words, looking for something in those billions and billions of bits of data in that individual tumor, that's different. As I said, DNA, RNA, proteins. And then we found the code. We think we got it. We think we figured it out. We think we know on the map where the treasure is located. Prove it. And that goes to exploring the relevance of the proposed solution, the clinical validation with a targeted therapeutic. I mean, it's great to say, there it is, but you got to have a drug that's going to impact it. And that's of unknown difficulty. I gave you some examples where we were able to prove the value. But that is the process we're going to go through. And finally, the question is, how do you take that single experience, which I will call N of one, which I will tell you right now is going to be the new paradigm in cancer treatment therapy. How do you go from that individual experience, that individual patient, and find out, is it 1 out of 50, 1 out of 10, or 10 out of 10, where it works? And so, almost to the end, what I'm going to show you now is the future of cancer medicine. Randomized trials are over. Now, the FDA doesn't know it yet, and my academic colleagues surely don't know it yet, but I'm showing you here is the future. And it surely is the future. If one of your patients has cancer, or a family member or loved one, I'm showing you the future. This was a paper published in 2012 in the Journal of Clinical Oncology, the major journal of the oncology community. As you can tell, there were a lot of people interested in it. It had 23 authors on it. It's called ROS1 Rearrangements to Find a Unique Molecular Class of Lung Cancers. Pretty boring title. Remarkable paper. Not for what I'm showing you on this slide. What these investigators did, and it follows, I'm going to say, follow everything I've been telling you, is they did some very eloquent studies in the laboratory, which showed that this particular abnormality, ROS1, if you, in fact, use this drug that had been approved for an entirely different tumor, ALK, could impact the cells, kill them, completely in the laboratory. This is nothing more than a nice experiment, nothing more than that, nice publication. They went further, and they actually had 1,000 total specimens. And they wanted to look to see, okay, how many patients' tumors actually had this abnormality. And it was 1.7%, 1 out of 50 patients. You would never look for this, would you? How could you think of doing a randomized trial? Why would you ever, 1 out of 50? It's too small. On page 867 of the journal, this is your patient, this is my patient. It may even be a family member. This is the real world. This is what is important, not the in vitro testing, which is the start. This is hidden, buried in this paper. Surely wouldn't have gotten the paper published. What got the paper published is the stuff I just showed you, but here it is. The patient is a 31-year-old male, never smoker, diagnosed with multifocal bronchoalveolar carcinoma in August 2010. For those of you who don't know, I can tell you this is completely untreatable cancer. There is no therapy for this cancer of any kind that's ever worked. Chemotherapy is worthless. It's a death sentence. Genetic testing of the tumor demonstrated no EGFR mutation, as I've talked about, and no ALK rearrangement. Remember, those are the two standard of cares. He was treated at an outside institution with first-line erlotinib, which is a therapy we use for EGFR. I mean, even though the mutation wasn't there, they used it anyway. What else could they do? I mean, they didn't give chemotherapy. We know that's terrible. So they gave him a relatively non-toxic but worthless therapy. As a result of progressively worsening symptoms and hypoxia, he was obviously drowning to death. He was referred to the Massachusetts General Hospital for additional genetic testing and was found to be ROS1 positive. On August 20th, 2011, the patient was started on crizotinib, which is the drug I've talked about, because they had it available to them as a trial. Started at a standard dose. In less than 1 week, he noticed significant improvement in symptoms. And by 2 weeks, his hypoxia resolved. Restaging scans at 8 weeks demonstrated near complete resolution of his multifocal lung tumor, which subsequently confirmed at 12 weeks. 6 months later, the patient continued on crizotinib, no evidence of recurrence. So in probably the greatest understatement ever in a paper in oncology, but almost certainly required by the editors of this paper because they're academics, this case suggests that patients with ROS1 positive non-small cell lung cancer may be exquisitely sensitive to therapeutic ROS1 inhibition. This is N of 1, and by the way, subsequent studies, not randomized, can never be done, have shown that the vast majority of patients respond, and now this is standard of care. This is the future. So how do we go? So I've given you the pitch to N of 1, but what do we do with that? That's one patient. The answer, I believe, is very straightforward. Web-based, public accessible, HIPAA-approved, highly secure platform where non-identified, objectively valid. Let me make it very clear. I'm not talking about a hocus here. I'm not talking about somebody saying, I feel better when the cancer is growing. I'm talking about having reference radiologists review imaging studies, acceptable tumor markers, et cetera, where treatment outcomes, short and longer term, an individual N of 1 experiences with a well-defined molecular abnormality and a targeted antibiotherapeutic are posted to be available to you, your patients, insurers, the FDA, employers, pharmaceutical companies, et cetera. And results that might take a decade, if ever, can be obtained and be available to view within months. What stops this from happening now is regulatory and greed, because none of the pharmaceutical companies, none of the academics, they all want to all own everything. But what about the patient? I thank you for your attention. So I know we certainly, it's closed. We have a few minutes for questions, if you have. Two really good questions. So let me repeat the first question is, so we take something like BRCA, and you say, okay, there's a mutation that exists in the, and that it's all, by the way, it's also in men, but obviously breast and ovarian cancer, we're seeing it primarily in women. Obviously breast cancer could be in men, but we see it mostly in women. Why does the cancer occur? By the way, well, we can see BRCA is actually relevant in prostate cancer and actually in pancreas cancer. But and so the answer is, the theory is, and you could also say, well, why in the breast and why in the ovary? Why don't we see it, for example, in the lung? And we don't have the answer to that. But the argument goes back to, it's really the sort of, it's an old theory, it's the two-hit theory. So what happens, what BRCA is important for, at least it's believed it's important for, is to repair DNA damage. So an individual patient with a BRCA mutation has got a big negative. So if there is another hit, if there's another mutation, whether it's, you know, sun exposure or carcinogen, that one of the major repair mechanisms doesn't exist. So that woman, we're talking about women here, might actually be able to repair most of the damage or all of the damage for a long period of time, but at some point, statistical probability, because she's missing that very important repair mechanism, she will develop the cancer. So the argument is, it's not an absolute to develop cancer. It's just that because of all the exposures, a really important repair mechanism doesn't exist in her cells. So that's the answer. The second question is, I've overstated. By the way, there are mutations and there are other mutations. And so, yes, you target this, and then resistance occurs, and there are a lot of mutations. Very valid point. And that's why I emphasized we're on a journey here. This is a process. I gave you some very impressive results, and obviously you could ask me, well, what about pancreas cancer? The answer, we don't have anything. What about the other patients with lung cancer? We don't have anything. So we're learning. And so what I would suspect is what we're really talking about is we will have some groups that we're going to find drugs, and then we might be combinations. By the way, maybe immunotherapy. There may be resistance. We'll learn about that. We'll treat the patient with that. And it is going to be cancer. These cancers will be increasingly managed as chronic illnesses. There is a giant in the room that I didn't discuss, and I want to say it now. How do we afford all this? Because obviously what I've just said is meaningless. We can't get the drugs. And, you know, we can't go on with, drugs that cost $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 a year. And by the way, let's do them in combination. So I'm making an assumption here. I'm making an assumption that we eventually have a rational healthcare system where one can argue you can do exactly what I said, switch from drug A to drug B as we learn new mutations. And that, and by the way, we may then, you know, then that mutation may there may be a resistance, we treat the resistance, maybe the original mutation comes back because we haven't killed it. We can find that out maybe through looking at the blood. Liquid tumor biopsies are being explored. So that's my answer to your question. This is a journey. This is a process. We are nowhere near being able to say, we can treat all cancers. And as I mentioned, we're just looking at the DNA. We are really at the early part. Because the DNA may say X, but there is no protein doing that. And we've not figured that out yet. That comes. So it's a very fair question. That's why I emphasize this, the process. Sir.
Thanks for a stimulating lecture. What are your thoughts on genetic privacy for individuals from government insurance? The most private thing we have is our DNA.
It's a huge issue. And again, made the point about my last slide, I don't mean to be flippant on that. It's okay. It's a slide. There's so much there. This is a huge issue. It is a massive issue. And by the way, as you probably know, there's federal law that says you cannot discriminate in health insurance, but you can still discriminate in employment, and you certainly can discriminate in life insurance, and you can discriminate in disability insurance. So the law is absolutely inadequate. So again, just like the cost issue, I'm making an assumption, and it's only an assumption in the sense that it's got to be done before we can do this. The idea, let's publish, put all the stuff online, it's secure, et cetera. Absolutely possible. It's possible to do. We're nowhere near there. And there is no way that I would advocate that we should have, you know, all of this genomic material and sequencing the gene and having people carry it in their pocket, which you can, you know, basically have it on a pin drive now, and think it's secure today, because it is not. But again, there are ways to potentially do it. Apple notwithstanding, there are ways to be able to make it secure, clearly. And so I'm making an assumption that we deal with the genetic discrimination issues. I'm making an assumption that we have that security because it's critical. Because if we don't, then all of this makes no sense.
I want to just follow that up, because my concern is not only for, sorry, my voice. I worry about the insurance part of it, which you just alluded to, but what about the personal trauma, I guess, to patients? You know, you're being told that, you know, you have a gene now that you're potentially going to have pancreatic cancer, breast cancer, et cetera. How do you have the family members deal with that, not only knowing that they may not get insurance in the future or disability insurance in the future, but also now that you're telling a 20-year-old that they now have the probability of getting a cancer. How does this whole genetic thing deal with
that? That's why I said at the beginning I would need 2 hours or more. Because you're absolutely right. Again, I took the genetics part off the table only because I wanted to give that high level. You're absolutely correct, and I very specifically gave the two examples I gave and not others, because those are abnormalities that are actionable for today. In the case of breast cancer and ovarian cancer, bilateral oophorectomies, bilateral mastectomies will reduce the risk of death by 80% for those women, certainly in ovarian cancer. Clearly, those individuals with Lynch syndrome, hereditary polyposis, et cetera, you all know, enormously high risk of developing colon cancer. Again, those are easy ones. I mean, the patient could ultimately say, I want to accept the risk, but you've got an incredible opportunity for therapeutic intervention. But as you said, and that's why I put Alzheimer's disease up. They're telling somebody you have got a double lifetime risk of Alzheimer's disease. Well, quite frankly, it's still a small number, but double the risk, you know, exactly what you said. Or you have a risk of pancreas cancer, there's nothing we can do about it. This is very complicated, which I think some of you know, there's an incredible debate going on now within the genetics community, where many are arguing if you find these abnormalities, even if you're not looking for them, you've got to tell patients about them, just as you said. But what do you do about it? So again, this is a very complex area. It's very important that you are all involved in it for the benefit of your patients. And again, I don't mean you should become geneticists, but your point is very well taken. You know, we have 23andMe out there, okay? It's free enterprise. I'm very in favor of free enterprise, but wow, I don't know what that stuff means. And you know, this is why I said about the tsunami. Listen, I'm not saying yes or no, it's good or bad, it's there. I mean, I just gotta know it's there. And by the way, if the FDA says you can't do it, you can go over to China and get it done. So, the fact of the matter is we've got to figure this out. It is not a question of keeping it away. Patients will get it. By the way, it doesn't cost that much now. That's my point. But it's not interpretable. You are correct. It's not interpretable. We don't know what it means.
In your lecture, you mentioned that a small amount of the colon tumors had the gene that would respond to aspirin. But there's a whole slew of polyps that are removed, and I've never seen a report on that. Is there any studies where the polyps are being evaluated, and perhaps aspirin or Celebrex may help prevent the recurrence of colon polyps?
Oh, very good questions. Again, unless there's a pharmaceutical company interested in some of this, and or somebody can get a grant like these people did, you're talking about a very long-term study, and it's a very good question. The United States Public Health Service group just recommended aspirin. I certainly am not an advocate of many of their recommendations. This one, I think the data are very strong on. Again, from your perspective, obviously, there's the risk of aspirin. We know there's risk of aspirin. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm talking about the cancer part. And actually, they approved it specifically for heart disease and cancer prevention. But obviously, aspirin, bleeding, et cetera. So there's a lot of issues that go into that. Your question is very good. For example, could we predict the patients whose polyps would lead to colon cancer? They might need more surveillance. Incredibly important question. I don't know how you're going to get to that, because you got to get someone to study it. You got to get someone to get paid to study it.
A quick question. I know there's a lot of industry looking into these areas of research and everything, but I know the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation, and recently I think the founder of Napster, I think it's Steve Parker, donated $250 million into this area of research. What's your opinion on how they're collating these centers doing this research to try to, you know, push this forward?
Yeah, the Sean Parker's money was actually given, as I understand it, specifically for immunotherapy. One of the, which is again, I alluded to, a very exciting area as well, specifically in that area, which is, again, extremely important. See where that goes. There was a number of very wealthy individuals working with Illumina, which is a giant in the technology area for coming up with these machines, are looking for examining, you know, again, the sort of the holy grail. They're looking for a liquid tumor biopsy. Liquid tumor biopsy is basically taking stuff out of the blood and looking at what you might see in a solid tumor to try to find cancers before they develop. So they're looking for this. We can look in the blood. We can find an abnormality. We can know that somebody's going to have cancer before there's any other indication of it. My opinion, that's fool's gold. And the reason is because none of these abnormalities are that specific. And by the way, you want to talk about genetic testing and being concerned? You say to a patient, oh, you've got an abnormality in your blood that says you have cancer. We can't find it. We don't know where it is. We've done imaging all over your body, and we don't know where or when it is. I mean, okay, so... Yeah, you want to talk about nuts? I think that's nuts. Now, again, they can get a lot of investors, because if you found it, wouldn't it be incredible? I'm just telling you, biologically and at a clinical level, I just don't see it. I just don't see that, you know, there's nothing that specific about these abnormalities. That's why it's a small number of cancers that we would all probably ever be able to look at this risk part, because number one, you've got to be able to say it's pretty darn specific. And number two, you've also then got to, well, what am I going to do about it? I mean, the breast and ovarian cancer one is a beautiful story. And it's true because you can say it's specific enough for the breast. We've got these family histories. We've got all the data. And, you know, I'm always very careful when I talk about, you know, removing organs from women. I take care of women. I do gynecologic cancers. I've taken care of women in my entire career. So it's easy to take out the ovaries and breasts. That's not my point. My point is that there actually is something actionable. It's not just let's wait. So that just, and by the way, once it's wait, it might be metastatic, et cetera, et cetera. So it's an interesting idea. There are a lot of ideas out there. And by the way, there's a lot of money, people looking at these kinds of things. There are a lot of companies. And it's because the data is there and you can do it now. But whether it's going to be clinically relevant, I don't know. But yes, your patients will come and ask you about those. Thank you very much.